Hey guys, I hope you're holding up okay and keeping busy. This is sort of a second part to the last Badpixel Builds episode. We're going to be sticking with the PPE theme, but in this one, we're going to be moving from face masks to face shields. Stick around. We've had a few requests since the last video, so we'd like to clarify a few points. We're not selling these devices, and none of this effort is for profit. Our intention here is to produce as many pieces of gear as we can and then provide them to essential workers in our community. Our hope in making these videos is that some people out there with the means will watch these and run with it. If you would like access to any of our STL data, just ask in the comments and we'll gladly provide the files. We'll also answer any questions we can to the best of our ability. In the last couple of weeks, we've seen a ton of large organizations pivoting their manufacturing to produce mostly face shields for frontline workers. While chatting with a plastics vendor about filament recently, he told me about how tight supply has been getting on certain clear plastics commonly used for face shields. While acetate film, also referred to as overhead transparency, isn't as rigid or durable as some of the other plastics being used for face shields, it's lighter, far less expensive, and best of all, it's available in literal reams everywhere stationery is sold. We decided to see if we could get these sheets to work in a shield design. 7 versions, and 2 weeks later, and here we are. Here's the rundown. Once again, we'll be using Solidworks for our design work. Our model started with a sketch of the basic proportions of the open source Prusa headband that's been floating around. The original STL file is available at prusaprinters.org. Our redesign focuses on 2 major feature updates. First was the addition of sort of an angled deflector brim at the top of the band to provide more shielding over the brow from overhead spray. In the original design, there was quite a large open gap between the user's face and the shielding material, which would easily let droplets through. Our second mod is the shield fastening mechanism. We updated the whole fastening system to accommodate standard letter-sized acetate transparency sheets, which can be found everywhere stationery is sold. As mentioned, thicker acetates, plexi, and optics are more commonly used, but they're getting increasingly difficult to source. The final solve was an array of 3 magnets and 2 hooks along the band. The setup for this was really easy and straightforward. The part fits on a standard bed and no support is needed. Once we locked down the design, we started tinkering with the settings and managed to get our print time down to under an hour with our M2. Unlike the mask prints from the last video, non-antimicrobial filament can be used to print these headbands. PETG filaments are recommended over PLAs for final prints due to their higher resistance to heat and sanitizing chemicals. The first step in assembling the shield is placing 3 magnets into the circular indentations on the front of the band. The model accepts 6x1mm neodymium magnets. We used a 2-part, 5-minute epoxy to adhere the magnets to the band. The next step is to prepare the acetate sheet for installation. The hooks on the front of the band are spaced exactly 108 millimeters apart. This was done to allow an acetate sheet to be prepared with one hit from a regular 3-hole punch. Once the holes are punched, just hang the acetate sheet on the hooks, place the 3 loose magnets over the film to lock it into position, and you're good to go. FDM prints are inherently porous. While parts can appear solid to the naked eye, when magnified, we can clearly see large gaps and pockets left behind between passes of the extruder. These cavities can trap contaminants and easily become a breeding ground for bacteria if proper sanitization procedure isn't followed. Carry out these steps to sanitize a 3D printed component. 1. After each use, wash the component thoroughly using liquid dish soap and rinse with clean water. 2. Disinfect the component using either a 70% ethyl alcohol bath or a solution consisting of one part household bleach and 99 parts cold tap water. If using a bleach solution to disinfect, make sure the part is thoroughly rinsed before using the bleach. Certain soaps can produce toxic fumes when combined with bleach. 3. Rinse the component using water that's been boiled for at least 5 minutes. And 4. After air drying the parts, store in a sealed container until next use. And that's that. If you have any questions or suggestions on this episode, please comment and join the conversation. We'd love to hear from you. Once again, if you'd like access to our STL data for these models to try and print some of your own, just let us know, message us, and we'll gladly provide them and answer any questions we can. Thank you for watching. If you found this useful, please share this content with anyone you think would run with one of these projects and help out with the effort. See you next time.